I want to start off with a few thoughts here concerning the concept or the idea of demands. Have any of you, and you don't have to answer out loud if you don't want, but have any of you ever been demanded to do or not to do something? Have any of you been demanded to speak or hold your peace? You know, when we hear the word demand, I demand you to do this, or someone was demanded to do that, oftentimes we look at it with negative connotations. Demand. It's a word that perhaps is offensive to us. Demand? But if you, and by the way, to demand something is to ask by authority or to require as necessary. A demand. You ask by authority to do this or not to do that. Or it is something that is required as necessary. But if you were perhaps an engineer or even a mechanic, is there something demanded of you if you're going to, and righteousness, for some apparent reason, we think that we cannot attain the standard? But God would not require of us anything that He will not give us the power to attain. Amen. Perfection is not a perfect knowledge. The Bible is clear. The judgments of God, for example, the Bible says, are unsearchable. And His ways past finding out. The judgments of God, we will not be able to completely comprehend. We don't understand why all things happen the way they do. We don't understand it all, in other words. In fact, there are some things that we are told not to seek after. The secret things belong unto who? God. The Lord our God. But that which is revealed belongs to us and our children. And so there are things that God, in His omnipotence, in His righteousness, has decided to keep from us. And it is not our prerogative to seek after those things. But everything that God has revealed is for us to know. And it behooves us to find it. But perfection is not knowing it all. In fact, those who think they know it all are not perfect. So if perfection is not a perfect body, is not an exemption from temptation, it is not a perfect knowledge, what then is perfection?
Jesus.
Morality. Jesus.
Spiritual
something.
Maturity.
All right, well, let's see what the Bible has to say. Let's compare scripture with scripture, as we're told to do. Let's go into Bible study here. First of all, go with me to the book of Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32. Notice here what the Bible brings out as to what perfection is. Now, these are biblical answers here that I wanted to give to you this evening. Deuteronomy what chapter?
32.
That's where we're going, and we're going to go to verse 4. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 32, verse 4, He is the rock. His work is what?
Perfect.
Okay? Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. He is the rock, referring to Christ. His work is perfect. Not only that, let's go to 2 Samuel chapter 22. 2 Samuel chapter 22. His work is perfect, the Bible says. Notice what we read here in 2 Samuel chapter 22. In verse 31 is where we're going. The Bible says here in verse 31, as for God, His way is perfect. The word of the Lord is tried. He is a buckler to all them that trust in Him. So not only is His work perfect, the Bible says His way is perfect.
What verse is that again?
31
of chapter 22, 2 Samuel. One more, Psalm 19. Just by me mentioning that chapter, you may know what the verse is. Psalm chapter 19. And here we find something else.
7.
Verse 7, exactly. Psalm 19 and verse 7, the Bible says, the law of the Lord is perfect. So we find here that his work is perfect, his way is perfect, and his law is perfect. Now let me ask you this. Is his work righteous? Of course. Is God's work righteous? Everything he does is righteous. Is his way righteous?
Yes.
You would agree. Is his law righteous?
Yes.
Of course it is. In short, the righteousness of Christ is perfection. And if we therefore attain this righteousness, we consequently attain perfection. The way of the Lord, the work of the Lord, and his law are righteous and perfect. And if we attain this righteousness, we attain consequently perfection. Now, by what can we attain this righteousness?
By whom?
We'll get to that point. By what?
The word of God. By his word.
Let's go to Romans chapter 3. This is an easy answer, brothers and sisters, but it can be answered in many different ways, I understand. Romans, though, is where we're going to find this answer that I'm looking for. Romans, what chapter?
3.
Chapter 3 is where we're going. Notice what the Bible says here in verse 21. Romans chapter 3, 21. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by
faith
of who?
Jesus
Christ. Unto all upon and upon all them that believe. So here we find that this righteousness of God is by faith. And not just any faith, but the faith of Jesus Christ. Now let's compare this also with Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, by what can we attain this righteousness, brothers and sisters? It is by faith. But not just any faith, not man's faith. In fact, man's faith is also a gift. Man cannot produce faith in and of himself, friends. The faith that is given to every man as a measure is a gift from God. And that faith also, when applied, is the faith of Jesus. But notice here what the Bible brings out in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 9. It says, and being found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of who?
Christ.
The faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. So here we find here that it is by the faith of Jesus that we attain this righteousness. And again, if we attain this righteousness, we consequently attain perfection. The faith of Jesus, brothers and sisters, is what I want to dwell upon this evening. In fact, what is the faith of Jesus? This quotation here from Third Selected Messages, before I do address the question I just asked, notice this quotation that says, the soul-saving message, this is page 184, the third angel's message is the message to be given to the world, the commandments of God and the faith of who? I want you to keep that in mind. If you don't have any other impression by the time that this study is over, I want you to have a deep impression of the faith that is of Jesus. The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus are both important, immensely important, and must be given with equal force and power. The first part, that is the commandments, the first part of the message has been dwelt upon mostly. The last part, the faith of Jesus, casually. The faith of Jesus is not comprehended. We must, what it? Talk it. We must, what else? Live it. We must, what else? Pray it. And educate the people to bring this part of the message into where? The home life. So that's what I want to do this evening. The faith of Jesus. But what is the faith of Jesus? Let's go now to the Bible, Hebrews chapter 4, as we contemplate on this faith that is of Jesus. Jesus' faith, in other words. Hebrews chapter 4 is where we're going. And notice what the Bible says here in verse 15. It is clear, we have not an high priest. When I hear pages turning, I want to slow down. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. It says, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without what?
Sin.
So Jesus, as he walked upon this earth, was tempted in all points as we are, yet he never succumbed to sin.
Amen.
Ever. Not even in thought. Now let's go to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I hope you brought your Bibles along because we're in a Bible study this evening. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. Yet without sin. Now notice verse 21 here. It says, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew how much sin?
Yes.
No sin. That we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So God made Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin for us in our stead, so that we can be made the righteousness of God in Christ. But again, I wanted to emphasize the point that Christ knew no sin. One more on this point, 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2 is where we're going. And notice here what Peter says in 1 Peter. Chapter 2, verse 21 is where we're going to read. It says, then verse 21, who by him do believe in God that raised him up from the dead. One moment here. Let me find the right verse. Chapter 1, verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. Now notice the steps. Who did how much sin?
No
sin. Neither was guile found in his mouth. Now here we find in three different places, three different testimonies that Jesus Christ was sinless. He knew no sin. He lived a life upon this earth and never did he sin. Never did he go contrary to the will of his Father. Now, how was it that Jesus was able to walk upon this earth as a man and yet commit no sin? All right. First, let's go to verse 23. Same book and chapter. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 23. It says here, who, when he was reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. Jesus committed himself totally and completely into the hands of his Father.
Amen.
And it was by doing that that Jesus was able to live a life free of sin. Notice also what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2. He committed himself into the hands of his Father. Here we find Christ speaking in this manner in Hebrews chapter 2. And notice here what Christ did throughout his life. Hebrews, what chapter? That's where we're going. And we're going to look at verse 13. Just the beginning of that verse here. This is Christ here speaking. And verse 13, it says, and again, Christ speaking, he says, I will put my trust in him, referring to his Father. Jesus Christ put his trust implicitly in the hands of his Father. And again, as a result, he was able to walk this life free of sin. Now, we know that we are told, in fact, by Christ himself, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by how many words that proceed out of the mouth of God? Every single word, not a jot or tittle, should be lacking. Man must live by every single word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now, was there ever a man, a human being who walked on this earth who was able to fulfill that completely, to live a life never contrary to the will of God, living according to every word that came out of God's mouth? Was there ever a man who did that? Of course it was. And brothers and sisters, this is how Jesus also had no advantage over us. Just as he lived by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of his Father, so must we have the same faith. Amen. Jesus lived by every word that proceeded out of his Father's mouth. And consequently, he knew no sin. And if we're going to have the faith of Jesus, we will find ourselves also living by every single word that comes out of God's mouth. And if we're living by every single word, does that leave any room for compromise? Does it leave any room for sin? It does not, friends. Every word of God. In fact, do you know that in many times you can, the Bible shows that it was prophecy that was guiding Jesus along the pathway from the manger to the cross. Now he's been tempted. He knew that by prophecy he was going to be betrayed. And various other things that this study does not go into, that Jesus knew by the word, because he had to depend upon the word of God just as we do. And friends, that's what the faith of Jesus is. In fact, A.T. Jones put it in this way. In Advent Review and Sabbath Herald, this is January 17 of 1899, it says, faith, and this is the faith of Jesus, mind you, is depending upon the word of God only and expecting that word only to do what the word says. Amen. But many of us don't even know the word of God. God's word is not abiding in our hearts because we don't spend adequate time in getting to know it. How then can we have the faith of Jesus? What then should our faith be in? Our own thoughts, friends. The concepts and ideas of man rather than that of God. Faith is dependent upon the word of God only. In fact, the Bible says in Isaiah 55 and around verse 11, how God sends his word. And he says that his word shall not return unto him void, but it will accomplish that for which he sent it. I tell you that if we have the word of God living in us, hence if we have Jesus Christ living in us, then if we are surrendered to God, then just as God sends the rain upon this earth and it does not return void, it accomplishes that for which God sends it, so will his word accomplish in us that which is pleasing to God. But we must be surrendered to God. Faith is dependent upon the word of God only and expecting that word only to do what the word says. Now, in dealing with perfection of character, and especially as we look to the perfect model, it is unavoidable, perhaps, to avoid a very controversial subject when considering perfection, and that is dealing with the human nature of Christ. What was Christ's human nature like? Let's go to the Bible. Romans chapter 8. We have biblical scholars in the room. Romans chapter 8. And notice here what the Bible brings out to us as we are seeking to have the faith of Jesus. Romans chapter 8 and verse 3 here, the Bible says, For what the law could not do in that it was weak through faith, through the flesh, God, sending his own son in the likeness, that word also means in the form of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. So the Bible here says that God sent his son in the form of sinful flesh. But let's compare this also with Hebrews. Hebrews what chapter? All right, let's go there. Hebrews chapter 2, and we're going to look at verse 16 and 17. God sending his son in the likeness of sinful flesh. Hebrews chapter 2. Notice here what we read, and let's go to verse 16. Verse 16 here is sufficient. It says, "For verily he took not on him the nature of Adam, of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham." Verse 17, "Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest." So here we find that Christ took upon himself not the nature of angels. The angels had a perfect, sinless nature, not degraded by the fall. And I'm referring to the angels of God. But he took on him the seed or the offspring of Abraham. Now, inspiration brings out an interesting note on this point. And I'm not going to spend much time on this point, but I wanted to mention it because of the subject we're studying, looking unto Jesus. This is what inspiration brings out to us in the Bible Commentary, Volume 5, page 1131. In taking upon him man's nature, in what kind of condition? In its fallen condition, Christ did not in the least participate in its sin. Now notice here, it says that Christ took upon himself man's nature in what condition? In its fallen condition. Not only that, but it had to have been a sinful condition, else it could not be said that he did not participate in its sin. Christ took on himself man's nature in his fallen condition, but he never participated in the least in its sin. It goes on to say he was subject to the infirmities and weaknesses by which man is encompassed, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying he himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Now let me just stop right there to make a point, perhaps to agitate things. Christ took on himself man's fallen condition. And because it is noted that he did not participate in its sin, suggested also that it was a sinful condition. But how would you feel if I told you, or how would you be affected if I made known to you that Christ had a perfect, sinless human nature? In fact, I'm not going to tell you that. I'm going to let inspiration tell you. It goes on to say, we should have no misgiving in regard to the perfect sinlessness of the human nature of Christ. You say, wow, how can I reconcile these? Christ having a fallen nature, sinful, yet he had a perfect, sinless human nature. You see, brothers and sisters, yes, Christ took upon us, it's simple, Christ took upon us our nature in his fallen condition. But because he never succumbed to sin, because he never participated in the least, therefore, his nature remained spotless, sinless. And this is the example that is set before us. As a man, Christ did this.
He could have.
And been eternally lost. Our faith, it says, must be an intelligent faith, looking unto Jesus in perfect confidence and full and entire faith in the atoning sacrifice. So yes, he had a fallen, sinful condition, or he had man's nature in that condition, yet he was sinless. That's why he was able to say that the enemy cometh and he hath nothing in me.
he rebuked the devil in the desert?
At least three times.
Using the word.
So how, because of this example that we have before us, what then is Christ able to do? Notice here in Hebrews chapter 2, just one chapter over, verse 18. This is what he is able to do because of what he experienced. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 18, the Bible says, "For in that he himself hath suffered, being tempted, he is able to succor or to help them that are tempted."
Amen.
He suffered being tempted. Inspiration lets us know that he suffered because it was painful for him to be just to be brought into contact with sin. Painful to him. We cannot understand that, I'm afraid. But by the grace of God, we can get to that point to where we intensely hate iniquity and have a zeal and a burning love for righteousness. He is able to aid us who are tempted. Not only that, Hebrews chapter 7, notice what it says here. This here is also mentioning the faith of Jesus. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 25, it says, "Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost." That means completely or entirely. He is able to save who? That come unto God by him. Those who come unto God by him, he is able to save entirely. He is able to save to the uttermost, completely, all that come to God through him, because he ever liveth to make intercession for them. So here we find what Christ is able to do because of what he has gone through for us. Again, as I shift gears here, what is the Christian's aim? Remember our key text? Everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. That is the aim, the definite aim that must be set before us, and we must not allow anything to derail us. We must not allow anything to detract us from reaching that aim. This is the aim that is set before us. A.T. Jones mentions it in this way in the book, The Consecrated Way to Christian Perfection, page 45. Perfection of character is the Christian goal. Perfection attained in human flesh in this world. Christ attained it in human flesh in this world, and thus made and consecrated a way by which in him every believer can attain it. Perfection is the Christian's goal, and the high priesthood and ministry of Christ in the true sanctuary is the only way by which any soul can attain this true goal in this world. Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary, Granny Ann.
Amen.
That's why what we were studying about the sanctuary, as Granny Ann was mentioning about the importance of knowing where Christ is now. Of knowing that he is actually in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, which is real and literal.
Amen.
They're conducting the final atonement. As we are living in the antitypical day of atonement, the time to afflict our souls, to reach and to gain this perfection, it is only as we know where Christ is. That's why those who do not believe that Christ is in the most holy place cannot attain this perfection.
That's right.
Because as the pioneer brought out, the only way by which this can be attained. So then, what is the secret of success in the quest for perfection? What is the secret for success in our quest for perfection? Let's go to John chapter 15. This is the secret of success, brothers and sisters. If we're going to attain perfection, if we're going to be as our master, there's a secret by which we can attain this. Yes, it is by the faith of Jesus. And the faith that Jesus had led him to live a life without sin. If we have the same faith, yea, total dependence upon the word of God, then we also will live by every word that proceeds out of his mouth. But here is the secret of this success. John chapter 14 and verse 15. I'm sorry. John chapter 15 and verse 4. Christ speaking, he says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine. Ye are the branches. I am the vine, ye are the branch. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do how much?
Nothing.
Nothing. So here we find the secret of success in this quest for perfection is that our humanity must be blended with Christ's divinity. Yes. Our humanity must be blended with the divinity of Christ. In the book Cole Porter Ministries 106, it says the secret of success is the union of divine power with human effort.
Amen.
Those who achieve the greatest results are those who rely most implicitly upon the almighty arm. That's why I mentioned earlier the importance of us spending time with God in prayer. In the searching of the scriptures, we are not truly relying upon the arm of the Almighty. We're relying upon our human reasoning skills. And that, brothers and sisters, is not getting us anywhere. We're still here. We must rely implicitly upon the arm of God, upon the righteousness of Christ. In another place, it says in Messages to Young People, the Christian life is a warfare. In this conflict of righteousness against unrighteousness, we can be successful only by divine aid. Our finite will must be brought into what?
Submission.
A word that we don't like, at least the activity thereof. Submission, brothers and sisters, we must learn to truly submit day by day, moment by moment to God.
Amen.
In fact, you break this word down, you have submission. In other words, our mission is to be sub or under Christ. Submitted to him, to the will of the infinite. The human will must be blended with the divine. This will bring the aid of the Holy Spirit. So humanity and divinity must be blended together. And what parts of humanity must be blended with divinity? I heard the will. Not only that, Christ took upon his nature. Actually, let me read this quotation. I have this quotation before that. Christ took humanity to stand here in our world to show that Satan had lied. He took humanity upon himself to demonstrate that with divinity and humanity combined, man could keep the law of Jehovah. Separate humanity from divinity, and you can try to work out your own righteousness from now till Christ comes, and it will be nothing but a failure.
Amen.
You cannot separate divinity from humanity and try to attain perfection. It will not work. But again, what parts of humanity must be blended? It says there is not an impulse of our nature, not a faculty of the mind, or an inclination of the heart, but needs to be moment by moment under the control of the Spirit of God.
Amen.
So every impulse, every inclination, every faculty must be blended with divinity. Moment by moment must be under the control of the Spirit of God. The thoughts that we have, the desires, our reasoning skills, whatever it may be, our judgment at all times must be under the control of the Spirit of God. That's why we must learn the science of praying without ceasing. It is those who learn to pray without ceasing shall cease from sin. So here we find the parts of humanity that must be blended with divinity. Now another question, which is not directly tied to this, but it goes somewhat with what we're discussing, and that is dealing with division. Because we read earlier that there must not be a division between humanity and divinity. In the second presentation this morning, we heard a powerful message from Pastor Allen about perfection. And this perfection was in a certain realm. What was the realm in which this perfection was in? The home. Brothers and sisters, if you were not able to hear that message, I suggest you get it. Every one of us are a part of some family. And the condition of the church, the condition of society, the condition of our world is based upon and dependent upon the condition of our homes.
Amen.
How are we relating to the inmates of our own dwelling? There is strife and there is divisions that are taking place, not just in the churches, brothers and sisters, but in the homes. But also, although there is this division and there is the cause of it, there is also a solution. What is the cause of and solution for division? Notice what inspiration. The cause of division and discord in families and in the church is separation from Christ. So in other words, if there is strife in the home, if there is strife in churches, strife in nations, whatever it, wherever it may be, then that is evident that someone's humanity is not blended with Christ's divinity. Someone is separated from Christ. And this is the cause of division. Inspiration goes on to say, the secret of true unity in the church and in the family is what? Union with Christ. That's the solution. Union with Christ. And then she gives this wonderful illustration. Picture a large circle, from the edge of which are many lines, all running to the center. The nearer these lines approach the center, the nearer they are to one another. Brothers and sisters, that's what we must be doing. We must be drawing earnestly, perseveringly to the center of the circle. There is where we find Christ. There is where we find his righteousness, his purity, his loveliness. But the problem is, although many of us, perhaps all of us, are illustrated by these lines going to the center, the problem is, with many of us, we stop somewhere along the way. We do not reach the center of the circle as we should. And do you know why we don't reach the center? Yes, it is boiled to self, true indeed. But what we find is that the closer we get to the center of the circle, I recall a brother mentioning this to me, in fact, when I was discussing this very thing with him. And I told him, I said, brother, I am striving. I want to get to the center of the circle. And he told me, he says, I want to warn you. If you get to the center of the circle, you're going to have a dislocated hip. Who is that referring to?
Jacob.
It's referring to Jacob. We don't want to experience the pain that is involved in reaching the center of the circle. We don't want to experience the self-denial and the self-control and the self-sacrifices that are so much needed in reaching the center of the circle. And as a consequence, we are still here today. Brothers and sisters, we must reach the center of this circle. This is the solution for the divisions, not just in families, yes, not just in churches, but also in our individual lives. We are divided from Christ, thinking that we are united with him. His divinity is not blended with our humanity, because our humanity, every impulse, every faculty, every inclination, is not subjected to him. We want to do our own things. We want to call ourselves Christians, but don't want to wear his garments. Foolish virgins we are, friends. Foolish virgins. In conclusion, and it is somewhat long conclusion, but I want to wrap things down. Again, by what can we attain the righteousness of Christ and consequently perfection? The Bible is clear that it is by the faith of Jesus. In fact, Habakkuk tells us that the just or the righteous live by his faith. And not merely man's faith, because man's faith is Jesus's, because Jesus gave it to him. But we can claim it as ours because it gives it to us as a gift. Just as I can say that is Jesus' wife. But I can claim her as my wife because he gave her to me as a gift. It is the faith of Jesus. Romans also tells us that the righteousness of God is by the faith of Jesus Christ. So again, I ask, what then is the faith of Jesus? In summary, this is what the faith of Jesus is. Inspiration brings it out. Selected Messages, Volume 3, page 172. The faith of Jesus. It is talked of, but not understood. What constitutes the faith of Jesus that belongs to the third angel's message? Jesus becoming our sin bearer that he might become our sin pardoning Savior. He was treated as we deserve to be treated. He came to our world and took our sins that we might take his righteousness. And notice this, faith in the ability of Christ to save us amply and fully and entirely is the faith of Jesus. Perfection, in other words. Faith in the ability of Christ to save you entirely. In other words, you do not have to continue to deal with your anger problems. You do not have to continue to deal with your lust. You don't have to continue to deal with any other issue, any other sin that you are battling with. There is no one too low or too vile to which the hand of the omnipotent cannot reach down and pull them up. Amen. We have hope in the faith of Jesus. But friends, we don't understand it, let alone put it to practice. A.T. Jones put the faith of Jesus this way in the same book, this time page 28. For thus it has been demonstrated to the very fullness of perfection that there is no man in the wide world for whom there is no hope in God. No one is so lost that he cannot be saved by trusting God in this faith of Jesus. This is the faith of Jesus that is given to men. This is the faith of Jesus that must be received by men in order for them to be saved. This is the faith of Jesus.
I gotta change it.
Help us to keep our eyes stayed on Christ. In Jesus' name. Brothers and sisters, we must understand the solemnity of the times in which we're living. Yes, we can look out into the Adventist world and we see the madness, the degradation. Brothers and sisters, Adventism as a structure is lost.
Amen.
Sad to say, as the Jews, irredeemable. You know, there are many parallels that I have come to recognize between the structure of Adventism and those of the Jews in the days of Christ. But interesting enough, there's also parallels that I have come to recognize between this small independent movement that Christ had in Galilee with the independent movement of today. We heard it mentioned earlier, John 6:66. Many of the disciples turned back and walked no more with him. And today, even among what is so-called historic Adventism, we see the same taking place. Just because you are not in a conference, just because you are perhaps in some independent church, does not in itself mean that you're going to go through.
Amen.
Salvation is an individual thing.
Amen.
And we must each have a personal daily walk with God.
Amen.
as Enoch did. Closing up here, we find, continuing on, in what 18 Jones says, the faith of Jesus. This is the faith of Jesus, which now in this time of the third angel's message must be received and kept by those who will be saved from the worship of the beast and his image, and enabled to keep the commandments of God. This is the faith of Jesus referred to in the closing words of the third angel's message. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So this is the faith of Jesus of which we are studying. And once we have this faith of Jesus, what will this faith of Jesus lead us to do? Now, there are many things I understand, but there is something specific that the faith of Jesus will lead us to do. And I love this quotation from Early Writing 72. True faith lays hold of and claims the promised blessing after or before? Before it is realized and felt. So true faith lays hold of and claims the blessings of God even before you actually realize it, even before you in reality receive it. It goes on to say that we must send up our petitions and faith within which veil?
Second.
The second veil. We're in the most holy, brothers and sisters.
Amen.
That's where we must send up our petitions in faith therein. And let our faith take hold of the promised blessing and claim it as ours. That's why Jesus was able to say, if you should say to this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, and not doubt in your heart, in other words, you don't waver, in other words, you're single-minded instead of double-minded, you shall have the things that you say. You should have the things that you pray for because you have the faith of Jesus. We are then to believe that we receive the blessing because what has hold of it? Our faith, that is the faith of Jesus, and according to the word, it is ours. We don't have this faith today. This is the faith that we need. It says here, here is faith, naked faith, to believe that we receive the blessing even before we realize it. When the promised blessing is realized and enjoyed, faith is swallowed up. Prior to this, she mentioned how faith is not feeling. The two are distinct. Faith is ours to exercise, but joyful feeling and the blessings are God's to give. But this is what the faith of Jesus will lead us to do, to lay hold of and claim the promised blessings of God even before we realize them. And as we have these blessings and have a hold of them by faith, we can walk in victory. We can walk with confidence, with assurance, because we have not our own faith, brothers and sisters, but the faith of Jesus.
Amen.
What then must we do to persevere until the end? Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, looking unto who?
Jesus.
Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. It goes on to say, before that, let us run this race with endurance. Blessed is the man that endures temptation. In other words, to stand up underneath it, though it may be heavy, though the pressure may be intense, you will not buckle. The greatest want in this world is the one of men we just read not too long ago. Men who will not be bought, sold, who in their inmost soul are true to duty as the needle to the pole, calling sin by its right name. The faith of Jesus will lead us to do that. In closing here, messages to young people. We have before us a warfare, a lifelong conflict with Satan and his seductive temptations. And in order to win the crown of life, we must put forth earnest, persevering effort. Don't give up, brothers and sisters. Some of you right now may be dealing intensely with some serious sin. And many times you may have become so discouraged to the point that you want to give up. To the point that you think that there is no salvation for you. Brothers and sisters, do not give up. Not to fear, friends. We have a mighty conqueror, and the Bible says, greater is he that is within you than he that is in this world. Amen. We go on to say that we must still have that persevering effort. We must not lay off the armor or leave the battlefield until we have gained the victory and can triumph in our Redeemer. As long as we continue to keep our eyes fixed on the author and finisher of our faith, we shall be safe. Amen. And also, the last quotation, the greatest victories of the church, well known. And again, that's why I emphasize this point in the beginning. The greatest victories of the church of Christ or to the individual Christian are not those that are gained by talent or education. In fact, we have been told, and this is another quotation that I enjoy because it is so serious and I take it to heart every time I read it. But we have been told that not all who profess to keep the Sabbath will be sealed. In fact, she says there are many, even among those who teach the truth to others, who will not receive the seal of God in their forehead. They had the light of truth, so you couldn't teach them anything. They understood every point of our faith. They knew their master will, but they did not have corresponding works. And then it gets even more specific. It says, these who were so familiar with our prophecies should have ordered their households after them, that by a well-ordered family, they can present to the world the influence of the truth upon the human heart. It's not enough to know the truth, friends. We must live it.
Amen.
So here in this quotation says, it's not those that are gained by your talent or your education, no matter how much you may claim to know. That is not where the greatest victories to the church or to you as an individual are gained. It's not gained by wealth or the favor of men. They are those victories that are gained in the audience chamber with God. And we are neglecting, we are avoiding, we're not entering into that room. Do you know that if we're not entering into the audience chamber with God, that is synonymous to not entering into the most holy place? Every time we enter the audience chamber, brothers and sisters, we're entering the most holy place. When earnest, agonizing faith lays hold upon the mighty arm of power, those who are unwilling to forsake how many sins? Every sin. And to seek earnestly for God's blessing will not obtain it. You will be lost. But all who will lay hold of God's promises, as did Jacob, and be as earnest as persevering as he was, will succeed as he succeeded. Brothers and sisters, the Bible says that everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. Do you want to be as your master?
Amen.